morning. Good morning, second time.
Good morning.
Puppies. Freshly fallen snow when we want it to be spring. Pine trees. Time. Psalm 24 says that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. This building, the chairs that we sit in, the homes that we came from, the air that we breathe, you, me, all of us. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. We've come together to worship, and so at this time, we're going to worship the Lord who made all of these things, everything in it. So please stand in body or spirit as we give glory to God.
Away my sin, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my part in this I see nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Nothing can for sin atone.
Nothing can for sin atone. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And this is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. One last time. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Sing this with me.
And I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. And I believe you are the way and the truth and the life. And I believe you are the way and the truth again, and I believe you are the way, the truth, the life, and I believe you are the way, and the truth.
Keep worshiping the song King of Kings. In the darkness we were waiting.
Thank you.
pray. King of kings, Lord of lords, creator and sustainer of everything, you are the way and the truth and the life. You've given us that life, and we praise you and thank you that our failings, our sins, our mistakes, they have been wiped away and forgiven, just as white, or whiter than even the snow that has fallen outside this morning. And so we thank you that we can come together and give you praise. In your name alone that we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. It's good to come together as the people of God this morning to worship and to praise him, to give him thanks for who he is and for what he has done. Thank you for working together to worship in a little bit different space here for a few weeks. We're just trying out, drawing closer together and being able to see one another in worship, and we're experimenting with all the sound and all those kind of things to try and make that come out well and things to work well on the live stream that's going out to people as well. So always a few bugs to take care of. If you're at a spot where you need to like get into a place a little further away from here, maybe with some children or something during worship, the monitor is on in the cornerstone room, so that could be a little spot where you might go and to do that if you need to. Today is the second Sunday of the month, so we have our mission offering that's being received today. The baskets are up front in the corners, I believe, and also in the back for placing your offering in. As I see one over there, I don't see one on that side. So at some point in time during the worship service this morning or afterwards, just find that offering basket and put your offerings in there today if you would. Also, just for our prayers today, Beth O'Donnell has been struggling over the past few weeks in and out of the hospital, most recently in rehab at Rest Haven. Now she is at Spectrum Butterworth downtown at the Meyer Heart Center. She's got a couple of blood clots, one in each lung, that they are monitoring at this time. And just ask that you keep Beth in your prayers if you would. What kinds of things would you like to pray about as we come before the Lord this morning? I thought we're close together here. What would you like to share as items that you'd like to have us lift up in prayer? Okay, very good. So prayers, thanks, Tracy, back getting around more easily again. Thanks for prayers for him over the past few weeks. So what else? Praying for Ukraine, okay? Very good. We'll lift up Ukraine in our prayers. What else, Sam? Oh, okay. All right, so Sam and Helen have purchased a condo. Yes. Okay. Okay, Sam's stuff needs to be sorted through. Okay. Okay, so that's going to be a big transition for you folks, isn't it? Yeah, okay. Keep them lifted up in prayers. Yes. Okay, so you're going to be on the north side next to the Maynards. All right, very good. So you've got some Central Park people close by then. So, Pam. Praying for Ukraine, yes. Yep. Yeah, all right. Yes. Okay, so our Afghan family, they're in that apartment now that was rented for them on, okay? Yep, they're in. Thank you for all of the contributions of stuff that has helped that to happen. Maybe a few things that need to happen yet. If there's another list, we'll make that known that we might need a few more things. But thank you so much for all the people who helped, all the people who donated to help that happen. Vicki. Praying for Russia, yeah. Yep. Yeah, there's just such struggle going on in the world with what they're doing, what's happening. So, okay, yep, we got letters going out this week and conversations happening with elder and deacon nominees. So we want to be praying for that. Very good. Others, Jeff. Yes. Okay. All right. So Aunt B is having some trouble with her eyesight now. So. 98 years old. Let's keep B in our prayers. So, Korea. Something's going on in Korea as well. Just unrest, huh? Okay. All right. So unrest in Korea. Yes, Norma. Happy birthday to me. Oh, well, you may, but it's early. Yeah, it's not until March 27. Look at you're 2 weeks early, so. Oh, now it's, yeah. It's a long time from now, so. Everybody forget that even was brought up, so. Thank you for thinking of me, though. Okay, pray for nation and president. All right, very good. Yes. Okay, there we go. Robin's birthday today, so there we go. Happy birthday, Robin. Yes. Happy birthday. Kim. Okay. All right, the unmentioned prayer request. Okay, got it. It's nice that God knows all those things. Okay, very, very good. Let's join our hearts together in prayer. Lord God, we give you thanks that you are God who does know each and everything that's on our hearts and on our minds. That even though we may not mention things in a community of people, you know the thoughts of our hearts, you know the burdens of our hearts, and you hear and answer those prayers. And so we lift up, first of all, those unspoken prayer requests this morning, things that that just weigh upon our hearts, that we can't mention in a group of people, but you know what they are, and so we pray that you'd bring resolution and peace and hope. We live in the midst of a world that is in turmoil, unrest in so many different places, protests and concerns and political unease, and we pray for Ukraine and Russia, Lord. The connections and the communication that has been happening around this world over the past many years is all of a sudden just changed because of a conflict in Russia and Ukraine. And even though it's not a world war in terms of fighting, it's become a world conflict in terms of the connections between people and between nations. And we are afraid that it's changed how this world works and operates. And so we ask that as the Prince of Peace that you would come and that you'd reign in peace in that area. We pray that there would be some means for Russia to back off from their intentions of conquering Ukraine, and that there would be peace in that area again, that there would be the protection of life and safety for people there. Lord, we pray that you'd be at work in leaders of countries that talk together, converse together, share together, threaten together, that in the midst of all these things that there might be a pathway to hope and to peace for our world. We pray for our president, for our leaders, for those who are in Congress, and pray for them and decisions that are made both domestic and foreign. And just in all these things, we know that we are so dependent upon you for each and everything that we would have for every day. And so we ask that you would be at work in those parts and places and ways in our world. We pray, Lord, that you be at work in the episodes of our lives, the transitions that we make from place to place and time to time. I want to give you thanks for how you've been at work in Tracy's life, that he went through a time of sickness a couple of weeks ago, and you have been restoring him to health and strength. And I just want to give you thanks for the way in which you have done that, enable him to get back into worship again today, and we just trust you for continued healing there. We pray for Aunt Bee, and at 98 years old, her sight is getting dim, and we pray that you would continue to nurture her and nourish her. We do pray for healing for her. We pray that her sight might improve, that there might be some ways in which something to be able to be done, or that she might be able to continue to see. We thank you for the positive attitude that she has had toward life with all of the challenges she's had in the last couple of years. And we just pray for the healing that you alone can bring. We pray for Beth O'Donnell in Spectrum Hospital with a couple of blood clots, one in each lung. Lord, we pray that those blood clots would stay in their place until they dissolve or until they're able to go in and get them out. We just trust Beth to you and ask that you bring about the healing that she needs. And we thank you for the ways in which you are able alone to do that. Now we pray that you be with Sam and Helen in a transition that they're making from one place of residence to another, and just ask that you'd be with them in that transition as they leave behind that independent home ownership and the place where they've been and move to a spot that's smaller and probably more on one level, and we just trust that you would be at work with them and walk with them in this time of transition. We thank you that we get to support and encourage them along the way. Thank you, Lord, for just calling us to come alongside of a family from Afghanistan. Our eyes and our hearts have been opened. Our scope has been broadened as we have reached out to them, as we've prayed for them, as we've given stuff from our lives and our pocketbooks and our homes to help them have a home in this place. We pray that you be with them in this time of transition, that they may settle well into the apartment that that they now have. And just ask that you'd enable us to continue to come alongside of them. Pray for them and we pray for them and their transition in this country, that they might find here a place of safety and of rest. And Lord, we lift up their prayer concerns for family members that they still have that are in Afghanistan who are struggling to have enough to eat, and just with the situations in their particular country. And Lord, there wasn't that long ago that we were praying for Afghanistan and the unrest that was happening there. And it seems like now our attention has shifted to Ukraine and Russia. But Lord, the people in Afghanistan are still suffering. And we pray that there would be peace that's brought in that region of the world as well. Lord, this world so desperately needs your presence and your power and your peace. And we ask that we might be agents of that. By the prayers that we offer, by the gifts that we give, by the ways in which we converse with one another, by by the things that we do as your people from this place. And we pray for your servants in all of those places in this world, and ask that they in those places might serve with their hearts and their minds and their pocketbooks and their bodies in ways that bring about your peace, your kingdom upon this earth. Lord, we long for your will to be done on this earth as it's done in heaven. We know that that's not happening very much right now, but we long for it to happen, and we invite you to do it in and through us, through your people all around this world, in this day as we worship you and praise you and serve you. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing again.
I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy in all my days. Oh, yes, I will. That again, I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy in all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. I will, and I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names, that nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify.
will. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy in all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will.
All right, so at this time, we're actually going to try something new that we haven't done before. We're going to take 3.5 minutes, and we're going to have a countdown on the screen in case you are aware or want to know. But we're just going to take a few minutes to greet each other. Feel free to mingle around, talk with one another, grab a cup of coffee. Kids can be dismissed to Central Park Kids. And then we'll start singing a chorus, and that'll be kind of your sign to kind of come back to your spot, and then we'll continue on.
Yes, I will lift you high.
comes from Ephesians 4 and 5 out of the Message. What this adds up to, then, is this. No more lies, no more pretense. Tell your neighbor the truth. In Christ's body, we're all connected to each other, after all. When you lie to others, you end up lying to yourself. Go ahead and be angry. You do well to be angry. But don't use your anger as fuel for revenge. And don't stay angry. Don't go to bed angry. Don't give the devil that kind of foothold in your life. Did you used to make ends meet by stealing? Well, no more. Get an honest job so you can help others who can't work. Watch the way you talk. Let nothing foul or dirty come out of your mouth. Say only what helps. Each word is a gift. Don't grieve God. Don't break his heart. His Holy Spirit moving and breathing in you is the most intimate part of your life, making you fit for himself. Don't take such a gift for granted.
Make a clean break with all cutting, backbiting, profane talk. Be gentle with one another, sensitive. Forgive one another as quickly and thoroughly as God in Christ forgave you. Watch what God does, and then you do it, like children who learn proper behavior from their parents. Mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with him and learn a life of love. Observe how Christ loved us. His love was not cautious, but extravagant. He didn't love in order to get something from us, but to give everything of himself to us. Love like that.
Let's join our hearts in prayer. Well, Lord, when we hear those words of Ephesians 4 put into modern language, into our own terms, it comes close to home. There are bits and pieces of that we're doing pretty well, and then there are parts of that we need to work on. And so we have come before you humbly asking that you would help us to walk in the way of Jesus. We want to be on the same pathway that he was on. We want to be headed to the same destination that he was headed to. And so we just ask that you give us wisdom in walking in that way. In Jesus' name, amen. Mary and I started our ministry in a little town called Fairview, Illinois. And I started there on July 1, 1986. July 4, 1986 would have been the first holiday that we didn't have any family anywhere near us to do things with. And so we were at a bit of a lost end, left to figure out what it is that we were going to do on that day to celebrate our first holiday away from home and family. Early that morning, we looked out the front windows of our house, and there was an older couple from the congregation. Their names were Warney and Dorothy. They were retired dairy farmers in their late 60s at the time, and they had come to the front of our house with a rototiller and other gardening tools. And they were proceeding to grind up the grass on either side of the front sidewalk that went from the front porch to the street. And they began to plant flowers. And so we spent that 4th of July with Warney and Dorothy planting flowers alongside the sidewalk that led from the front of our house to the road. And we were welcomed by them in many, many ways into the town of Fairview. Warney and Dorothy were for us models and examples of what it looks like to serve in the way of Jesus. They used their hands, they used their time, they used their money, they used their abilities to serve the church, to serve us, to serve their community, to come alongside of so many people and to help them with just walking through the life of Christ. They were models and examples for us of what it looked like to walk in the way of Jesus. And all of us want to walk in the way of Jesus. We've come to faith in Christ. We're seeking after Jesus. We want to walk in his way as we go through life day by day. And so we're digging deeply into Ephesians 4, verses 25, through first part of chapter 5, and then also looking at some words of Jesus that share some of those same themes and thoughts as we walk and talk together. So this morning we want to think about that whole area of serving and how it is that we use our hands to do something helpful. And we have some words, first of all, from Jesus, from Luke chapter 22, verses 24 through 26. So hear these words. It says, "A dispute also arose among them," that is, among Jesus' disciples, "as to which of them was considered to be greatest. Jesus said to them, The king of the kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who exercise authority over them call themselves benefactors. But you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves. So the context of these words, where Jesus is saying that the greatest serve is his message to his disciples here. The context is the upper room. This is the time when Jesus is headed toward the cross. This is Thursday evening of Holy Week. He's in this room with his disciples. They've shared the Passover meal together, and he's, you know, broken body, shed blood, all those things for them. And they're talking together, and the disciples know that the ministry of Jesus is coming to a head. And Jesus knows that it's leading to the cross, and he's told the disciples it's leading to the cross. But the disciples have this idea in their minds that somehow there's going to be this political kingdom that they're going to be a part of, and they want to be in a place of authority. They want to be in a place where they get to make some rules and tell other people what to do. And so they're arguing among themselves or disputing among themselves as to who is the greatest, who gets to be at the right hand and the left hand, who gets the positions of power in this kingdom of Jesus that's going to be established. And of course, they are so far off from the mark. Jesus is a model for them of what it looks like to lead and to serve. And he says, you guys are following the model of the world. He says, the kings of the Gentiles do the kinds of things that you're doing. The kings of the Gentiles have titles, and they have authority, and they use their position to get other people to do what they want them to do. He says, I am king, therefore you have to obey me. You have to do these things. You have to accomplish these tasks. That's the kind of authority that the world uses. Jesus says, within the kingdom of God, in the way of Jesus, power and authority is used much, much differently. The one who leads, the one who is greatest, is the one who serves. The one who's willing to take on the lowly roles, the roles that the youngest would take, the roles that the lowest servants would take, those are the ones who are the leaders within the kingdom of God. Jesus had already modeled that where he, before they had the supper together, Jesus had washed their feet. He took on the role of the lowliest servant, and he went around and washed the feet of all of the disciples in that room. And he knew that after this day, he was going to go to the garden, he was going to pray and ask the Father to take the cup away, but he knew that he was going to have to fulfill that command of the Father, and that the next day he was going to die on the cross. He was giving up his life, being put to death as a criminal for our sake, for our sins to be forgiven. So Jesus laid aside what he would want and what would be comfortable for him and what would be wonderful for him in order that he might do what was best for us. Jesus says the greatest are the ones who serve. The greatest are the ones who give of themselves to help other people accomplish. Even leaders in our time and other times, the leaders that are the best are the ones that help the people accomplish what they need to accomplish. Leaders who make sure that their people have enough of what they need, that there's food and that there are jobs for them to have, and things run in an orderly and systematic way. The best leaders are the ones who serve and who help and who accomplish the things that need to be done. And so as we think about walking in the way of Jesus and imitating what it is that Jesus has for us here, we look at those places and roles where we might have some authority or responsibility. Perhaps it's a position at work where we are a supervisor, or maybe we're the boss. Maybe it's our company, and we go about that role not to force other people to do things, but to enable them to do things. We live in our relationships within our family or within the church in ways in which we seek to empower people and encourage them, and we serve one another in order that together we might accomplish things. Ran across a story of Frank Blake, who was the CEO of the Home Depot from 2007 to 2014. And Frank Blake had this vision for his company that the most important people to Home Depot were their customers. And the next most important people to Home Depot were their associates that worked with the customers all the time. Because if the associates that always were working with the customers were able to satisfy the needs of the customers, the customers would come back and they would have more customers and they would be prosperous as a company. And so one of the things that Frank Blake did as CEO of the Home Depot is that every Sunday he would spend a few hours writing thank you notes, writing notes of appreciation to employees of the Home Depot. He had this system where you'd have store managers watching for things that associates in their stores did, where they would, and they would pass it on up to the district level and say, here are some employees in our stores that have done great and wonderful things. And the district people would read all those stories that came from their stores, and they'd send it on to the regional level. And the regional officers would take those stories and say, here are the best stories, and they would send them to Frank. And every week, Frank would spend a few hours writing notes of appreciation. Not a note that said, hey, I heard you did a good job. Thank you. Way to be a wonderful employee of the Home Depot. No, he would write a personal note to every person, handwritten, specific to the situation as to what they had done. And would send it out to them. 25,000 notes of appreciation he wrote over that 7 years as CEO of Home Depot. People would take those notes and they would frame them and they put them in their place of work because they had been acknowledged. And there were times when Frank would also walk through the stores and just talk to associates and encourage them. And there's one time one of the associates came to him and said, Mr. Blake, could I have you rewrite that thank you note that you wrote to me? And he said, well, why would you want me to rewrite that thank you note that I wrote to you? He said, well, you know, when I got that thank you note from you, I thought, you know, surely this can't be a real handwritten thank you note. And, you know, surely it's this computer-generated thing. So I put water on it to see if the ink would run. And it did. So I know it was a real note. But now it's ruined. Could you write me another one so that I could keep it? Because it means so much to me. There was a leader who knew how to serve. And as he served, it changed the atmosphere in the whole company, all the way from the bottom to the top, because everyone was looking at ways in which they could serve and encourage those who were serving among them. The greatest serve the most. Well, the Apostle Paul takes this in a little bit different direction when it comes time for him to write to the Christians in Ephesus, and when he's encouraging them to walk in the way of Jesus, to imitate how Jesus had lived among them. And he says this, he says, anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. So he says, those who have been stealing. It's like, wow, and that kind of strikes us. Who's been stealing? Who in this church in Ephesus has been stealing? And are there so many people in this congregation that have been stealing that it merits a special mention by Paul? Those who have been stealing should stop stealing. Well, first of all, it's not not appropriate for believers to be stealing, but it seems that perhaps in Ephesus, as in many cities at that time, there was this real division between those who were wealthy and those who were poor. There was no middle class where people just sort of made it through life very well. Either they had lots and lots or they had very, very little. And I'm sure there's some people who had very, very little that found their way in life simply by going around and taking what they could from others who didn't, who had plenty. They figured those who have plenty will not miss much. Those who are the merchants that are always selling things, they're not going to miss, you know, a piece of fruit here and a blanket there. And they made their way of life by taking from others around them. And as those people became believers in Jesus Christ, Paul said, that's not how believers in Christ need to live. He says, instead of stealing, instead of taking, instead of making your way of life by taking from other people, find something to do with your hands and to do something useful. He is encouraging the people to do something useful with their hands. And there's more to it than just simply, you know, stop stealing and start working. Get yourself a job so you can pay for your own way in life. It's not just that. It's Paul is really calling the people back to what it is that God has created us to be and to do. You see, when God created us, he put us in this world to be fruitful and to multiply, to lead creation, to rule creation, to work in creation in a way that helps creation to flourish, to multiply and to be fruitful. And so he's given to us a whole variety of abilities and talents and gifts. And so when Paul is saying, do something useful with your hands, he's saying, find the work that God has created you for. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, it's a great passage about salvation. At the end of it, Paul says, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. And in that context, we always read those verses spiritually. You know, God's got some good spiritual good works for us to do, things to do in the church, but that's true in the world as well. That God, that each one of us is God's handiwork. Each one of us is created uniquely by God to do things within this world. And he's given us talents and abilities and passions and interests and things that we know and understand and our experiences of life that fit together in a way that we have something to add to the world. And so when Paul is telling them to find something to do with their hands that's useful, he's saying, find the thing that God has created you for. And so if you are going to go through life just stealing a little here and a little there to make your way of life for yourself or your family, you're missing out on the blessing of what it is that God wants to give to you and wants to do by doing something useful. And then he takes it one step further and he says we need to have something to share. You're going to do this not only to support yourself, but also have something to share. So notice the progression that's there. He says stop the stealing, stop just taking from others, find something that you can do that's going to enable you to live into God's plans and purpose for you and to support yourself and your family in this time, but then also share with others who are in need. Paul recognizes that there are going to be people who can't work, people who are disabled, people who are working but don't have enough. There are always going to be people in need, and so we need to be able to give, to share with those that that have a need. So he's taking people from the place where they were taking from others to supporting themselves, to then giving to those around him. He says this is the same thing that Jesus was saying, that those who are the greatest are those who serve, those who take what they have that God has put into them and they're serving in the places where they are. But as we listen to Paul's word here, and it says, you know, though anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, we think, well, you know, that doesn't apply to me. I haven't been going through life stealing. I've been, you know, I have a job. I'm supporting myself, my family. We're doing all right. I'm not taking from anyone else. So that part of the passage doesn't apply to me at all. I'm just going to push that aside. But something I heard this week that made me think a little bit differently about those words there and about Paul's whole concept here of doing work with our hands so we can have something to share with those who are in need. Listening to a podcast on Ukraine, as a lot of podcasts that I listened to in the past few weeks have been, and this happened to be an interview with a woman by the name of, I have to look at this because there's no way I can remember and pronounce it, Irina Borodenko. And she is a statistician at the School of Public Health at the University of Michigan, a Ukrainian-American, been here for 20 years or so. But she grew up in Ukraine when it was still part of the Soviet Union. And she was being interviewed on this particular podcast because she has relatives that are in Ukraine, and they were, you know, hidden in a basement while bombing was going on and things like that. And so it was sort of a human interest story that she was being interviewed and talked to because of the family members still in Ukraine. But a part of the conversation, they asked Irina about her experiences in Ukraine. And she talked about growing up in communist country in Ukraine. And when she was in her teen years, early 20s, in the late 1980s, she was a part of the protests that were happening there as the Soviet Union was beginning to break up. And she was a part of Ukraine when they voted for their independence, became independent from the Soviet Union, and became a free and independent country. Said, but one of the things she said was that she learned what it meant to be a citizen when she moved to Scotland. In 1993, she had moved to Scotland. I don't know if it was to go to school or what it was, but while she was there, she learned some things about what it meant to be a citizen of a free country. And so when she went back to Ukraine for several years before she moved to America, she was very intentional about living as a citizen of a free country. And she said, and the quote that struck me said, she said, what does it mean to really care for the country, to really feel responsible for this? She says, I don't complain that we are slow at reaching this goal or that goal. I have to put my hand to it. I have to make my hands dirty and do something. She used those same words that the Apostle Paul had used in this passage. He says we need to do something with our hands so that we have something to give to others. I don't complain that we are slow at reaching this goal or that goal. I have to put my hand to it. I have to make my hands dirty and do something. in that fledgling country, she saw herself as a citizen of a democracy. And she herself needed to contribute to how they lived together as a people. And she couldn't just sit back and complain and say, well, the leaders aren't doing this and the leaders aren't doing that, and just to whine about it. But she had to get her hands dirty and do something to help it become what it needed to be. And it made me think about how do we go through life just depending on the work that other people do. It made me think about being a citizen of the United States of America, a citizen of Michigan and of this community. How do I contribute to being a citizen of this particular community? You know, a couple months ago, there was a candidate that I hoped would run for Congress from this particular area. And I thought, you know, it would be good if I would write a letter to that person and say, you know what, I really hope that you run for Congress because I want to vote for you when the primary comes along. But I never did write the letter. You know, if I had money that I wanted to give, you know, besides money that I give to the church, and I wanted to give it to a political candidate, that would have been an opportunity to say, here's some money for your campaign because I want you to run, and here's some money that you can help to run for that particular office because I would really like to see you run for office over others who are running. But I didn't do it. I vote for people who are running, but I'm not that much involved. What about my neighborhood? You know, I love the neighborhood that we live in. It's a wonderful, quiet spot. But what do I do to contribute to the niceness of that community? Am I really helpful in that? Or am I just living off from the benefits that others around me are doing? And so when Paul says those who are stealing should stop stealing and do something with their hands, I take a step back from that. I say I'm not actively stealing, but maybe I'm passively stealing. I'm passively just taking the things that other people are doing and benefiting from them as I walk through life rather than contributing. And so what would it look like to actively, in the various arenas in my life, to get my hands dirty as I reign aside, to do something that changes the situations or the settings in which I live? What does it look like to do that in my family? What are the things that I want to have happen for our multi-generational family, and am I actively working at that? What are some things I want to have happen within the community where we live, and am I actually getting my hands dirty to help that happen? As we go on, what about as a church? Am I actively engaged in the life of the church that we are a part of? Or are we just going along using the benefits that others have given to us as we serve and minister together in this place? We all have gifts and abilities and talents that we can use, that God's blessed us with, that can be used in the life of the church, used in the life of the community in a wide variety of ways. And this passage should make us think about how can I take what I have, what I've been given, and use it in a way that blesses others? How can I get my hands dirty? You know, it's in the bulletin today again that we're looking for folks to help serve coffee, you know, after worship, to prepare beforehand, serve it, and then clean up afterwards. A simple task, but if we had, you know, 20 people that would sign up to do that, you'd only have to do it once every 3 months. We're getting to the spot where we're going to start up nursery again, and one of the things that holds us back is who are going to be the people that are going to be willing to be in the nursery doing the worship service. But we're getting to the spot where we've got some kids that are coming, and we want to be able to offer that each Sunday, and we need people who are willing to do that. I got a phone call last week from, it used to be Michigan Blood, the Michigan Blood Bank. They've got a different name now that I can't remember, but there's two different groups that draw blood in this particular area. There's a Red Cross that we work with every other month to have a blood drive, but then there's this other company that is doing it as well. And, you know, the need for blood is great, and they said, you know what, could you do a blood drive every month? You know, 1 month with Red Cross and the next month with us, and you know, my first thought was, I don't think we get volunteers to do that. And I don't want to double up the volunteer task for those who are doing it on the every other month already. I think that's about enough blood drawing that we could do. And I know people can't give blood more than, you know, once every 2 months, but if we had volunteers that could do two different blood draw times, we've got a beautiful spot here for drawing blood, and we could double the amount of resources that way for our community. Are we willing to get our hands dirty to do ministry? in the way in which God would enable us to do it here in this place. Apostle Paul says to, if you've been stealing, don't steal anymore, but do something useful with your hands so that you can have something to share with those who are in need. And I know that there are so many different places where we're living and where we're working, and we've got our work responsibilities, and we've got school, and you've got the PTA, and the or whatever they call the parent-teacher organization these days, and kids are in different sports activities, and there's work, and there's the community that you live in, and all of these places that you could get your hands dirty, and not everyone could be engaged at every place and every level. But think about it. What is it that God has given to you to do? A place where you can get your hands dirty and make a difference in the relationships that you have so the community that you're a part of can be blessed and people can know that they're cared for, that they're loved, that they're treasured. Because that's the way of Jesus as we walk through this world, because the greatest are the ones who serve and seek to lift others up by what God has given to them. Let's pray together. Lord God, thank you. Thank you for your son Jesus, who didn't pull back from getting his hands dirty in relationship with us. His model for us is just to be in there with those disciples who were just arguing about who was the greatest when Jesus was about to give himself up for them and for us. And yet he stuck with them, and he offered himself on their behalf and on our behalf. Lord, as we walk through life, it's so easy to say, you know what, I did this or I did that. I'm going to just take in these other arenas of life. And Lord, what is it that you might have in mind for us? What are the ways that you might want us to get our hands dirty so that others might be blessed? We want to walk in the way of Jesus, a way of serving, a way of giving. And we want you to be praised. We want people to be blessed. We want lives to be touched. So would you be at work in and through us as we seek to serve you? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing again. If you're able.
Could ever bring.
again. Build my life.
May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us that which is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory, dominion, and power both now and forevermore.